बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, आई एम डॉक्टर उज़्मा मंजूर। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस इंडक्शन ऑफ लेबर। ओके, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल डेफिनेशन। इंडक्शन ऑफ लेबर इज डिफाइंड, लेबर इंडक्शन इज द इनिशिएशन ऑफ द यूट्राइन कॉन्ट्रैक्शन बिफोर द स्पॉन्टेनियस ऑनसेट ऑफ लेबर यूजिंग द मैकेनिकल और द फार्माकोलॉजिकल मैथड्स इन ऑर्डर टू जनरेट द प्रोग्रेसिव सर्वाइकल डायलटेशन एंड सब्सिक्वेंट डिलीवरी। मीन कि पेशेंट इज़ नॉट इन लेबर, वी हैव टू स्टार्ट द लेबर। लेबर मीन स्टार्ट ऑफ यूट्राइन कॉन्ट्रैक्शन एंड सर्वाइकल डायलटेशन एंड डिलीवरी। सो वी हैव टू स्टार्ट दिस वन बाय आइदर द मैकेनिकल मैथड्स और द फार्माकोलॉजिकल मैथड टू डिलीवरी फॉर सब्सिक्वेंट डिलीवरी। द रेट ऑफ इंडक्शन ऑफ लेबर इज डबल नाउ। इट वॉज 9.5% इन 1990 एंड नाउ इट इज 22% इन 2006। Now significance, induction of labor is useful and at time it is life saving for both the mother and the fetus. At the same time it is not the risk free. So whenever we are planning for the induction of labor, we have to see what is the risk for the continuation of the pregnancy and what are the risks associated with the induction. If there is the continuation of the pregnancy is more with the risk factors, then we have to do the induction of labor. Now what are the indications? Indication we can classify in the maternal indication and the fetal indications. Maternal indication, it is maternal medical problem like diabetes mellitus. It is uncontrolled and patient is full term 38 weeks, then we have to deliver because there is more chances of intrauterine death. Then renal disease, it will aggravate with the passage of delivery. Lupus disease, intrahepatic cholestasis, heart disease. So in these patients, when patient is in the full term at 38 weeks, we have to do the induction of labor and deliver the patient. Now fetal indication for the induction of labor. Prolonged pregnancy, patient is post date now, then we have to deliver because still she is not in the labor. Then intrauterine growth restriction, RH also immunization. There is premature labor and patient is not in labor and there is a rupture of membrane, so there is a risk of chorioamnionitis, we have to deliver that baby. Fetal demise, intrauterine death is there and there is no benefit to live inside the uterus. Unexplained IUD in prior pregnancy, so we have to deliver before this gestation. Fetal malformations, then twin pregnancy, it is about 38 weeks and with cephalic lie of the presenting fetus, mean first fetus is cephalic. Then combined factors. Combined factor, patients, mother, preeclampsia and other maternal hypertensive disorders. Patients, mother, oligohydramnios is there, polyhydramnios is there. Now what is the contraindications? Contraindication, if there is a contracted pelvis, like it is cephalopelvic disproportion. So no benefit to start the contraction labor because pelvis is not adequate. Then placenta previa or the vasa previa. It is contraindication because patient will start bleeding. Acute fetal distress, no benefit. We have to rush for the delivery by cesarean section. Abnormal presentation, like any presentation, despite it is not cephalic presentation, so all other presentation we have to deliver by cesarean sections. Pregnancy following the classical cesarean section. And if there is a history of the repair of successful psychovaginal fistula, then we have to deliver by cesarean section. Previous myomectomy and the uterine cavity is open in the during myomectomy, so we have to deliver by cesarean section. Active genital herpes, there is umbilical cord prolapse, no need for induction, immediately we have to deliver the baby by cesarean section. Then breech presentation and previous history of the cesarean birth are relative contraindications for induction of labor. Now we plan the induction of labor. So first of all we have to see the Bishop score. Bishop score, what thing we will see? It is the dilatation of the cervix, consistency of the cervix, length of cervical canal and position of cervix. Mean ki four things we will see on the cervix and the fifth one we will see the station of the presenting part. So then we will score the Bishop score. It is 0, 1, 2, 3. Dilatation of cervix, it is the closed cervix, it is 0 marks. If it is 1 to 2 cm dilated cervix, then 1 marks. It is 3 to 4 cm, then 2 marks we will give. And it is 5 or more cm, then 3 marks we will give. Similarly, consistency of the cervix, it is firm, medium and soft, we will give 0, 1, 2. Length of cervix, it is more than 2 cm in length, then it is 0 marks. If it is length is decreased like 2 to 1 cm, then 1 marks. If it is less than 1 cm, then 3 marks. Similarly, if position of the cervix, it is posterior, 0 marks. Central cervix, 1 marks. Anterior cervix, 2 marks. Then station of the presenting part, it is at -3 station, 0 marks. -2, 1 marks. If it is below the spine, so they will give 3 marks. Then we will compile this Al-Bishop score. So in summary, we can say if it is a dilated soft central cervix, a face cervix, and it has the high Bishop score, it will favor the induction of labor. In otherwise, it is the ripe cervix. If cervix is long, tubular, closed, thick posterior, it means it is an unripe cervix, mean unfaced cervix, poor Bishop score. Now, what are the prerequisites of the induction? First of all, we have to confirm the date. So sometime patient has no sure of date. So in this case, we will have iatrogenic prematurity. So to avoid the prematurity, iatrogenic prematurity, we have to confirm the date by early scan, by our LMP, some pregnancy tests and some other things. Then indication for induction of labor still valid, because induction of labor is not without any risk factors. Third, appropriate counseling including the risk of cesarean section, because induction of labor, many time it is going end up with the cesarean section. So we have to explain the patient that we have to do the cesarean section at any point. Number four, consideration of the potential risk to the mother or the fetus. Then assessment of the cervix, we will see pelvic fetal size and the presentation. Its presentation should be cephalic, fetal size should be average, mean 2.5 to 3.5 kg. Pelvis should be adequate, there should be no CPD, and cervix we will see. Then monitoring of fetal heart and uterine contraction before the induction of labor. If there is fetal distress, we will not do induction. Now what are the methods for cervical ripening? We can divide into mechanical methods and the pharmacological methods. Mechanical methods, these are the Foley's catheter we will induce, laminar attents, hygroscopic dilators, acupunctures, membrane sweeping. And pharmacological methods are prostin, dinoprostin E2, mesoprostaglandin E1, prostaglandin F2 alpha, by oxytocin, cytokines, nitric oxide and relaxins. Now first of all, we will discuss the pharmacological method. Dinoprostone, prostaglandin E2, is 5 to 10 times more potent and has a fewer side effect than F2 alpha, and it is best suited for the induction of labor. What is the mechanism of F2E2? It results in the direct softening of the cervix by three mechanisms. It softens the cervix by altering the extracellular ground substance of the cervix by three mechanisms. It increases the activity of the smooth muscle of the cervix and the uterus to gap junction formation that is necessary for the coordinated uterine contraction of the labor. Other things, it is the foam available and the dosage. Foam, the prostaglandin E2 is available in the tablet or the pastry. So it is the name prostin E2 3 mg is available. It is inserted in the posterior fornix. Second dose, we have to repeat 4 to 6 hours. The maximum we can give 2 doses in 24 hours. So after the second dose, if still in not labor, though it is a failed induction. Then endocervical preparatal gel is available. It is 0.5 mg, can be repeated 6 hourly, not to exceed the 3 doses in 24 hours. Then vaginal gel is available. In nulliparous, it is given at the initial dose of 2 mg, then after this 1 mg at 6 hourly interval, maximum up to 4 mg we can give. Then cervidil, it is 10 mg vaginal insert placed in the posterior fornix with controlled release of dinoprostone over 12 hours. Then other tablet, it is prostaglandin E1 analogs, mesoprostol. It is a tablet available. So dose is 25 to 50 microgram. We can give it vaginally or orally at 4 hour interval. Then prostaglandin F2 alpha. In case of intrauterine death, or patient is in the first or second trimester most likely, then we can use prostaglandin F2 alpha by extra amniotic catheter. Now what are the complications for this prostaglandin E2? prostaglandin E2 pessary is available, we are putting in the vagina. So what happened? Uterine tachycystole mean more uterine contraction is less than mesoprostol. So less tachycystole as in prostaglandin E2 as compared to the mesoprostol. So mesoprostol there is more side effect in as compared to the E1. So what is common side effect? This is a uterine hyperstimulation, and due to hyperstimulation fetal heart rate changes will be there, and meconium strain is more common in mesoprostol. Uterine rupture in the scar uterus if she has previous surgery should be wide in the third trimester mesoprostol. So 1 in 200 in spontaneous labor will go, and 1 in 70 for the induction of labor will patient will go. Now what are the contraindication for prostaglandin? In case of bronchial asthma, epilepsy, hypersensitive reaction to the prostaglandin, renal disease and hypertension and peptic ulcer, we have to avoid these prostaglandins. Now third thing is the oxytocin. Oxytocin, this is injection available. The region is neurochrome posterior lobe of the pituitary gland. Mode of action and the effects, it increases the frequency and amplitude of the already existing contractions. So contraction is there, but only we will increase the frequency and amplitude of the contraction. Direct effect of the oxytocin on the myometrium is mediated by the phosphoinositide. Hydrolysis with the production of the inositol phosphate that act as a second messenger and lead to the mobilization of the intracellular calcium ion. The maximum sensitivity to the oxytocin is achieved by 34 to 36 weeks of gestation. Oxytocin is relatively ineffective when the membranes are intact. When we will rupture membrane, mean artificial rupture membrane, we will do the then release of the endogenous prostaglandin. It will sensitize the myometrium, so more contraction will be there. Dosage and administration of the oxytocin is that the half-life of oxytocin is 10 to 12 minutes. Then steady state level is achieved. Within 15 to 20 minutes of beginning infusion, 40 minutes, the steady state will be achieved. Mean it will have the good contractions. The injection is available in 5 international unit and the 10 international unit infused. We are giving in form of the infusions. The antidiuretic effects of the oxytocin increase the risk of fluid overload. That's why when we use in the normal line, there is 5% dextrose water is preferred solution, and usually 5 to 10 international unit we are added in the 1 liter of the solution. Then we will start the dose at the 1 milli international unit per minute. Maximum dose we can increase up to 32 milli unit per minute. The aim of therapy for increasing the syntocinone infusion is that there should be adequate uterine contraction. The adequate uterine contraction are 30 to 45 seconds with 3 to 4 contraction in 10 minutes should be there. When there is 4 contraction, 3 contraction in 10 minutes and it is of 30 to 45 millimeter, then it means there is a adequate uterine contractions. The infusion of the oxytocin we can monitor by manual, like we can increase the drops every 15 minutes or every 30 minutes, 10 drops will be increased. Or either by the infusion pump, we will settle the drops according to the 1 milli international unit per minute. Then we will increase every 30 minutes or 15 minutes according to the response of the uterine contractions. Now what are the side effects of the syntocinone? First of all, uterine hyperstimulation. Tachycystole with more than 5 contraction in 10 minutes, it means it is a hyperstimulation. So contraction of greater than 90 second duration or the increase in the baseline uterine tonus, this may lead to the late deceleration. So this is a side effect of the syntocinone. Second, when there is more contraction, the uterine rupture is very common. Previous cesarean section, and if patient is grand multipara and there is the obstructed labor, risk factors are there, then there is more chances of uterine rupture. Incidence is 4.3 to 12.5%. Third side effect of the oxytocin is the water intoxication. Because oxytocin has the antidiuretic effects, if we will use in the normal line, there is and for the more hours, more prolonged duration for the oxytocin use, there is the ADH effects. Symptom occurs as the plasma sodium concentration fall below 120 to 125 milli equivalent per liter. Then symptom will be nausea, vomiting, mental state changes, and ultimately seizures and the coma. Treatment of this overdose is that water intoxication. In mild cases, only discontinue the hypotonic solution. Restrict the fluid intake in severe symptoms. Then correction of the hyponatremia by saline infusion may be the necessary. Increase incidence of the neonatal jaundice for the baby. Atonic postpartum hemorrhage is common after the excessive syntocinone infusion. Amniotic fluid embolism is common, especially when membrane are intact and we start the syntocinone. So there is more chances of amniotic fluid embolism. There are the other mechanical method for the induction of labor. This is the membrane stripping or sweeping. It is a simple technique. Only we will insert inside the vagina, then sweep around the lower segment above the internal os in the circular motion. Mechanism is by release of prostaglandin, especially prostaglandin F2 alpha is released, then it will start the contraction. But disadvantage is that increased risk of the maternal perinatal infections, and it will cause a discomfort to the mother. Other methods, this is the artificial rupture of membrane, ARM, very common. It is a surgical method. It will release the prostaglandin. And advantage of ARM is that we can see the color of the liquor. So if there is a meconium stain, we will not prolong the labor. If it is clear liquor, then we will assure. And if for fetal monitoring, we can introduce the fetal scalp electrode if there is a rupture membrane. Otherwise, it is not possible fetal monitoring in case of asphyxia. Increase effectiveness of the oxytocin. If we want to start the oxytocin, then we have to do the ARM first, then we will start the syntocinone. Otherwise, there is permeabilism chances increased. Then uterine hypostimulation is not a risk factor in case of ARM. It is a simple method. Drawback. During ARM, what happen? If presenting part is not engaged, then there is a cord prolapse. Cord compression is common. Choriomyelitis, if patient no deliver, it is a prolonged labor and rupture membrane, then increased chance of infection to this uterus and the membranes. Rupture of vasa previa. Sometimes you see, we don't know there is a vasa previa. Membrane is vascularized. Then when we will do the rupture membrane, it will cause the vasa previa and immediately fetal distress will be there. Increased transmission of the HIV. In HIV patient, we will not do the ARM. Other mechanical methods are Foley's catheter, insertion of Foley's catheter into the cervix. Then we will inflate 30 to 50 cc of the sterilized solution and then we will give the traction. Mechanical methods, mechanical separation of the fetal membrane from the cervix and lower uterine segment. So local cytokines and the prostaglandin will release. That will act on the ground substance of the cervix to break down the cross links between the glycosaminoglycans. Then extra amniotic saline infusion we can start. But drawback is that there is an increased risk of the intrapartum choriomyelitis. Maternal neonatal infections are increased. Sometimes there is significant vaginal bleeding when there is low-lying placenta. Laminaria tent, this is the herbal method. Natural, synthetic, hygroscopic or osmotic dilators we are put in the cervix. Then it will start the cervical dilatation. But drawback is that increased maternal and neonatal infections. There is another drug, mifepristone. It is a RU486, anti-progesterone, 200 mg given orally, daily for 2 days prior to the ARM. It will produce the significant cervical ripening. Failed induction. Failed induction, I told you that in case of prostaglandin E2, we will use the 2 pastilles 6 hourly. If still patient not go in labor, then it is a failed induction. The rate is 3 to 35% of the cases. Induction of labor may fail and it is said to have the occurred if ARM is still impossible, means cervix is not dilated, after the maximum number of doses of prostaglandin that I told you, 2 doses of prostring we have used, but still cervix is not dilated, ARM is not possible, there is no contraction, then it means there is failed induction. And otherwise you can say when cervix is 3 cm dilated and you have did the ARM, but an oxytocin is also going for last 6 to 8 hours, but still there is no cervical dilatation, only there is contractions. It is also failed induction. When the induction fails, option are that attempting induction again at some point in the future or perform the sterile section. treatment of the uterine hypostimulation during the induction, first of all, if oxytocin is started, we should discontinue it. Then we have to monitor the fetal heart by continuous electronic monitoring. Then standard intrauterine resuscitation measures we have to do, give the IV fluids, plain fluids, then give oxygen to the patient, change the position to the left lateral position. And if still there is the more contraction, then use the subcutaneous injection of tocolytic drug beta 2 agonist terbutaline 0.25 mg subcutaneously. Meanwhile, prepare for the cesarean section and deliver the baby. Thank you.